So what makes folic acid and folate act differently in the body? Look, they don't really. So I think this is a point of everything that is said bad about folic acid is sort of true to an extent, but has been completely exaggerated in some circles. So what happens is you have an enzyme called dihydrofolate reductase, or DHFR, that is its purpose is not to metabolize synthetic folic acid, obviously, because that folic acid molecule doesn't exist in the food supply. Its normal purpose is that every time that you use folate to participate in processes outside of methylation, such as DNA synthesis, you wind up producing dihydrofolate as a byproduct. And DHFR recycles that and turns it into tetrahydrofolate, or THF. Tetrahydrofolate is what has the methyl group added to make methylfolate. So if you look at the chemical structure of folic acid and dihydrofolate and tetrahydrofolate, the only difference is that there are four spots that can have hydrogens added to them. And that if you listen to the sound of tetrahydrofolate, that's tetra, four, hydro, hydrogen, folate. So tetrahydrofolate has four hydrogens there. Dihydrofolate has two hydrogens there. Folic acid doesn't have any. And so the enzyme DHFR is doing exactly the same thing to folic acid that it does to dihydrofolate. It adds two hydrogens. Now you have dihydrofolate. Just as if you had put the folate through a non-methylation process like DNA synthesis. And so once you do that one time ever to a molecule of folate, now it looks exactly like the molecule of dihydrofolate that came out of the DNA synthesis as a byproduct, and it never again, ever, ever is any different than the, it never, never, never again becomes folic acid. So from the point that dihydrofolate reductase does that one time to the synthetic folic acid molecule, which is exactly what it's doing to the normal dihydrofolate that comes out of DNA synthesis. When it does that one time, that folic acid molecule is never again, ever different from any of the folate that came in food or any of the folate that was circulating in your body naturally. And so that enzyme just has to work twice on that folic acid molecule. Does that mean that you're doubling the enzymatic requirement because you got to do it twice? The first time, yes, but no, because these molecules are recycled thousands of times per day. So if you, like, let's say you take a methylfolate supplement or you get methylfolate from your vegetables or from your liver, from your legumes, what happens is that methyl group on the methylfolate gets used once, and then that folate molecule stays in your cells for 200 days and 18,000 times a day gets the methyl group added again, right? So you're talking about the molecule that comes into your body in that instance, it has to get metabolized twice. But when you're talking about getting metabolized another 18,000 times in that day, then that two times you had to do it when it came in, is the math isn't that different. So does that mean that there's no, does that mean it doesn't matter that it's synthetic folic acid versus natural food folate? No, not that it doesn't matter. There are a couple issues. So number one, we know that before they started adding folic acid to enriched white flour, that the only people who had synthetic folic acid circulating in their blood were people who took folic acid supplements. Now that they fortify enriched white flour with synthetic folic acid, which they do to prevent neural tube defects, which it does do, now that they do that, almost everyone in America has synthetic folic acid circulating in their blood. Why? Well, it's not because they are, Well, the reason right after you consume a couple pieces of white bread, the reason right after you consume that, that you have synthetic folic acid in your blood is because you tried to turn it into, normal food folate, but you exceeded DHFR enzyme capacity temporarily. Now, what would happen if you never ate white bread again? Probably the next day, you wouldn't see any synthetic folic acid in your blood because the enzyme would have time to process it. But what happens is no one eats white bread once, they keep eating it. So because when you measure someone's blood who eats white bread every day, because they probably ate some white bread that morning or the day before, and the day before, and the day before, and the day before, and the day before, there's always a little bit that's not getting metabolized in that moment, but it eventually gets metabolized. So the question is, does that synthetic folic acid, we call that unmetabolized folic acid, does that cause harm? There are scientific hypotheses that it might, and it might, but there's no conclusive evidence of that. So that's one side of the argument against synthetic folic acid. The other side of the argument is, now that you are giving the DHFR enzyme more work, that means that it might be less, detracting from the work that it has in recycling dihydrofolate that came out of the DNA synthesis reactions to make tetrahydrofolate. And so you could say if you're putting extra work on it to the point where you have unmetabolized folic acid appearing in the blood temporarily, is that detracting from the work it needs to do to recycle the folate that came out of DNA synthesis and allow you to do it again, or allow you to put that folate into the methylation cycle? It might be. That's a reasonable hypothesis. It would be great to have some well-designed studies to test that. So because there's another point that Ben Lynch makes, which is that folic acid blocks methylfolate from getting into cells. I'm going to have to look more closely at those studies, but I would be extremely surprised if when I get done looking at those studies, I do not conclude that folic acid didn't block methylfolate from getting in. It just outcompeted it from getting in. Why? Because it more effectively gets into the cell, and then what happens to it? It becomes dihydrofolate, tetrahydrofolate, and then it looks the same as the methylfolate molecule. So I doubt that argument has that much relevance. The ones that I just said, I think, are the most likely to have some relevance. Now, so what am I going to do? Well, I'm not paranoid about folic acid, but it's not the ideal form of folate. If food folate and methylfolate don't have these issues, why not just use the natural folate that doesn't have these issues? There's an answer to that, which is folic acid is cheaper. Folic acid is more shelf stable. That's why folic acid is used in multivitamins. That's why you know, if you added methylfolate to enriched white flour, the bread is going to have less folate in it because it's less shelf stable. Folic acid is better absorbed. That's why if you look at a methylfolate supplement and it says 400 micrograms DFE, that's dietary folate equivalents, that's not 400 micrograms of methylfolate. I don't remember the conversion factor off the top of my head, but it's a lot more than that because folic acid is absorbed so much more effectively than methylfolate that you have to add more and then use a conversion factor to bring it down to dietary folate equivalents, which means that is an extra dose of methylfolate and is equal to as if you had consumed 400 micrograms of synthetic folic acid, which is more effectively absorbed. So the reason that it's used in the public health sphere is more absorbable, more shelf stable, and cheaper. And because it's more absorbable and it's more shelf stable, that makes it even more cheaper because you don't have to add as much. You know, if you were using methylfolate, not only would it be more expensive, but you'd have to add more to account for the fact that a lot of it's going to get destroyed on the shelf and then less of it's going to be absorbed, right? So if you're talking about like the cost of a public health campaign to do something really simple to add a nutrient to junk food to make sure that to reduce the risk of neural tube defects, then it makes sense. But I think that who are we? We are highly motivated people who are trying to make the best choices, and we're willing to deal with a little bit of inconvenience or extra money to make those best choices. And if that sounds like you, then synthetic folic acid is not the best choice. The best choice is to deal with the inconvenience and extra expense of getting folate from food, or when you can't get the folate you need from food, to use a supplement that has folate in food form. But you know, listen to what I said and compare that to the level of what I think is, I don't like to be accusatory, but I think it's fairly accurate to call hysteria around the idea that folic acid is poison. And I actually think it's harmful, because this comes back to what I said before, and I know I'm kind of ranting now. There's people out there who think that because they cut out white flour out of their diet, that is unambiguously a good choice. Not really. White flour isn't a good food, and cutting it out of your diet is a good choice in the context of properly designing the rest of your diet. But you have to realize that if you're eating white bread all the time, you are the beneficiary of the elite heads of nutrition science and the government. I know people hate the government and mainstream nutrition, but look, you've been the beneficiary of these people spending 100 years figuring out what are people most likely to suffer from in nutrient deficiencies, and how do we do something cheap to stop that from happening. We add it to the junk that we know that we eat, because the junk fortified with nutrients listen to us if we tell them to eat 3 servings of legumes or leafy greens a day. And that's true, right? How many people eat the 5 to 9 servings of fruits and vegetables a day that the government recommends? It's a pain to do that. And so most people don't do it. And I'm not saying that you should eat the white flour, but look, in Guatemala, what did they add vitamin A to stop people from having vitamin A deficiency so bad that they would become permanently blind? They added vitamin A to sugar. Why? Because people eat sugar. And so you can tell people that sugar is bad for you and you'll get fatty liver. And in the United States, you will have zero risk to telling someone that, because there's nothing added to the sugar. But if you go to Guatemala, I don't know if they're still doing that, but let's say for the sake of argument that they are. If you go to Guatemala and you go around preaching to everyone to stop eating sugar because they're going to get fatty liver disease, what's going to happen? They're going to go blind, because these people are eating sugar that is their only source of vitamin A. I'm simplifying here a little bit. I know that there's plenty of people eating in Guatemala eating good things. But the point that I'm making is the general population that is benefiting from that campaign. Iodized salt. Why don't most people get goiter anymore in the United States? It's because iodized salt. Why do some people get goiter now? I talked to a cardiologist, William Davis, the wheat belly guy. I was talking to him, and he was saying, you know, the last 10 years or so, now all of a sudden I see people walking to the clinic who have goiters in their neck. Why? Because he's treating people in an area where the iodine is deficient in the soil, and people are being told to avoid salt. Well, there's contexts in which salt avoidance. Now, I mean, I don't want to compare salt to sugar, because salt is good for you in the right, salting your food to taste is good for most people most of the time. But it's still the same thing. The public health campaign did a cheap, simple, easy thing to get rid of goiter by adding iodine to salt. And so you come in and you say, salt is bad for you, it raises your blood pressure. Well, you know, now you're playing the lottery, because if you're telling people that in an iodine deficient soil area, they're going to get goiter. So look, it's like, white flour is bad for you, but when you decide that I'm going to do better, I'm going to do it for myself instead of be managed by the people running nutrition, you got to realize that the people running nutrition in the United States are not the dumbest people on the planet. I don't care what you think about low carb or saturated fat. I don't care what you disagree with them on. They are not the dumbest people on the planet. And when you eat six pieces of white flour toast every day, you're the beneficiary of what they decided to do to that to minimize the risk of severe clinical nutrient deficiencies. And so I'm very worried that there are people who don't see that nuance, and they think that they just cut out white flour and therefore they're better off. No, you cut out white flour. Now you need to do more work to make sure that you're actually getting your nutrients from whole foods, because if you were eating six pieces of white toast a day, you didn't have to worry about getting nutrients from whole foods, and now you do.